there have been a series of mysterious deaths, oligarchs overseas. Latest, Sergei Protosena, his wife and daughter found dead. This is at their home in Spain. Investigators looking into the possibility of a murder-suicide. This follows another Russian gas boss found dead. In my experience of covering Russia, when, for instance, journalists fall off balconies, or opposition leaders are poisoned, or things like this, it's not by accident. When you see these deaths, what do you think?
You know, it's easy for those of us in the West to sort of say, well, perhaps these are big conspiracy theories. Perhaps these people just died natural deaths. But the problem is that whenever you get somebody who speaks out against the Russian government, whether it's an oligarch or whether it's somebody who's inside of Russia, like Navalny, or whether it's any of the people that the Russians have killed or tried to kill outside of Russia, you begin to see this pattern of the Russian government going after its critics, regardless as to whether or not they're inside Russia, which makes it easier, or even outside. We can't forget Sergei Skripal a couple of years ago, who was living in Great Britain at the time and was, you know, the subject of an assassination attempt. So these oligarchs are in very difficult positions. If they're outside of Russia, they're uncomfortable with what's going on. It affects them economically. And they start speaking out against Russia. But then these things start to happen, which serves Putin's cause, which is to put a damper on these types of people.
Yeah.
CNN's Nick Robertson is following this for us. He joins us now. Nick, what are the details here and who are these men?
Yeah, the details are a bit gruesome. Sergei Protosena, 55 years old, former oil executive in Russia, living in a house just outside Barcelona in Spain. Now, the Spanish police discovered him dead in the garden and his wife and daughter dead inside the house. Spanish police have sealed that investigation while they're working on it, so we're not getting many details there. We are getting a few more details from the Russian investigation for the murders that appeared to happen the day before, Monday this week. Vladislav Avayev and his wife and daughter found dead in their Moscow apartment. Now, their nanny and driver alerted Russian authorities, or at least first alerted a relative of the family to say, we're trying to get through to them inside their apartment. They're not answering the phone. The door's locked. We can't get in. The police say that they discovered all three of them dead with gunshot wounds. Now, the Russian authorities are saying they're treating this as murder-suicide, which is, in many ways, tantamount to saying nothing to see here, nothing suspicious about this. Of course, having both these former oil executives die one day apart, both of them apparently, it appears on the surface of it, killing their wives and daughters, leaves a lot of room for speculation, looking at Russia's historic track record of being prepared to reach out and kill people who are criticizing the Kremlin and President Putin. There's certainly been a number of deaths associated with that in the past. Now, it's not clear that they have spoken out about President Putin, but certainly there's an atmosphere of towing the Kremlin line being pushed in Russia right now.
Absolutely. Nick, thank you so much. And joining me now is Bill Browder, CEO of Hermitage Capital Management. He was one of the largest foreign investors in Russia until he exposed Kremlin corruption in 2005. He is the author of a new book, Freezing Order, a true story of money laundering, murder, and surviving Vladimir Putin's wrath. Bill, thanks for being here. So do you think there is something more sinister going on here with these gas executives, what we were just hearing?
Well, it seems awfully suspicious. I mean, I don't know any of the forensic details of either of these two stories, but when business people die, Russian business people die, I think one kind of has to assume the worst first to eliminate that before going to natural causes of death. And we're in a very taut moment in Russia. Money is scarce. All sorts of people are under a lot of pressure, and it could easily be the most heinous outcome. I mean, the scenario could be, the worst case scenario, not something less heinous.
And it kind of gets at something I would love you to describe, the dynamic and relationship between men like these wealthy gas executives, or oligarchs, as we often are hearing about, and Vladimir Putin. How beholden are they to him and vice versa?
Well, the most important thing to understand is that Vladimir Putin is the mafia boss. He's the guy in charge of everything, and nobody has any influence over him at all. But he's also the president of the country, not just a mafia boss. And so if he wants to accumulate vast sums of money, he has to find people to hold that money for him, because he can't do that legitimately without being blackmailed as president. And so the oligarchs of Russia, these rich guys on these rich lists that you hear about all the time, these are the people who hold his money. And so as we talk about what do we do to punish Vladimir Putin and how do we freeze his money, we can't freeze his money by just putting him on a sanctions list. We have to put on the sanctions list all of these rich guys, all these oligarchs, and freeze their money in order to get to him.
You know, President Zelensky actually in his nightly address warned Russia that the sanctions it's already been hit with and will be hit with if this continues will make Russia as poor as it was after the 1917 Civil War. I'm curious if you agree and what impact you think the sanctions are having, forget on Vladimir Putin, but on the Russian economy.
Well, I don't quite agree with that, because there's one huge elephant in the room, and he's also pointed this out, which is that while we're sanctioning Russia, while we're freezing the oligarch assets, while we're freezing the central bank assets, et cetera, every day the West, and mostly Western Europe, is sending Putin $1 billion for the purchase of Russian oil and gas. And so they're getting literally hundreds of billions of dollars a year, if this carries on, from the West. And that doesn't make them poor. That gives them a lot of money, particularly when the oil prices are so high. And so the last big part of this jigsaw puzzle of sanctions is to stop buying Russian oil and gas. And that's going to be a big ask for countries like Germany, where nearly half of their gas comes from Russia, and other countries like Austria and Italy, where nearly 100% of their gas comes from Russia. But in order for us to starve Putin of the financial resources to conduct this war, that has to stop.
Given what you know about Vladimir Putin and what we've seen so far in this war in Ukraine, where do you think this war goes next?
Well, unfortunately, I think that this war doesn't go anywhere next. I think this war carries on and carries on and carries on. It's very clear that Vladimir Putin has no intention whatsoever of backing down. He's not a person who compromises. Any peace agreements, if they were ever agreed, would just be temporary, because he's not a person that he would do that for tactical reasons, but not any other way. And on the other side, I think that the Ukrainians are not going to accept the loss of their territory. And they've fought hard up until now, and they've been fighting very well up until now. And so I think that this is going to go on and go on and go on. And unfortunately, as it goes on, we're going to learn so many terrible, heartbreaking, tragic things about what's happened to the Russian people. I mean, I'm sorry, the Ukrainian people, in this war. And it's just, it's not going to be something that's going to be resolved anytime soon.
Yeah. Bill Browder, thank you for coming in.